I will try to talk about few essential things that I think it's worth considering. Since yesterday, I think there's a lot of discussion must have happened on about the role of higher education. Today morning, we spoke about quality, accreditation, and everything. Before I go into the specific topic, I was just want to bring your attention to select countries in this world, which I was fortunate enough to go as part of my work for UNESCO, as to see how they look at higher education and what is the governments there are thinking about. The first example is South Korea and Japan. The Ministry of Education in these two countries, you know how these countries are, how advanced they are, how progressive they are, but they are very concerned about a couple of issues, especially when it concerns the youth. Because when you talk about higher education, we are talking about youth. The first thing they are concerned is, are our students whom we are churning out from our system, are they socially responsible citizens? They are very concerned about the citizenship education. Similarly, they are also concerned about, is the education system as well as the industry is taking measures or addressing the issue of sustainable development? Because these countries, they feel that the world of work, the world of education, everything is changing. And it's changing, it's mainly not only about how good the company is doing or how the education system is producing top class universities and researchers. It's also concerned about the students who come out of it. Are they going to be responsible managers, individuals who's going to have socially responsible and committed to the community and the world? Someone asked this morning about, you know, you were talking about accreditation and research. What about, you know, interaction with the society? So here is very advanced countries doing a lot of, discussion is going on in that manner. Another country I want to bring your attention is Singapore. Singapore is kind of commercial in a sense that they want to promote their institutions to attract wide variety of students, make it more competitively viable, very competitive in a sense that they should match with the top universities of Europe and also North America. But at the same time, their educational institutions are concerned about not bookish, not classroom-based education, but about having hands-on experience with the industry. So universities there allow the industries, not just from Singapore, wide-ranging industries, both big and small, and entrepreneurs into the universities and teaching institutions, even at the school level, to allow this dialogue to happen. I'm specifically saying dialogue because when you talk about India, by and large, we are talking about industries coming only at the time of placements or maybe some research collaborations, by and large. Leave the IITs and the top universities. Then I want to bring your attention to another part of the world. This is to do with youth. Similarly, the youth of India and youth in Japan or Korea or in Singapore. This is youth in Syria and Somalia. these are youth who are living as refugees in another country, in Lebanon and Jordan, in Kenya and Ethiopia, Somali students, and they are also elsewhere. What does it mean for them as higher education? How do they go about, and what is important for them? For them and for the governments that host them, it's about survival. It's about using the education that they can have, if at all they have, is to somehow survive in this world and get out of that misery. So it's completely different. The role of higher education in that context is very, very different. And finally, Rwanda and Cambodia. Cambodia, which is in Asia, Rwanda in Africa. These two are, as you know, not long ago saw genocide happening, where millions and millions of human beings were butchered. These two countries, they look at education in a very different way. For them, higher education or school education is about creating a generation of youth who will work for harmony, reconciliation, and peace. And industry, which work in this part of the world, also are very conscious of that. So now, what I've told you looks, or you may hear something very, very different from all the debates that were being happening this morning. We were talking about qualifications, we're talking about higher research. But then if you look inwards into our own scenario, bulk of our colleges, institutions, like the arts and science colleges and many institutions, see, please don't forget, we also have vocational education, like the polytechnics and the ITIs. They are also, students are coming out of it. This huge population are really caught up as to where they are going to go next, how they are going to survive, and what sort of employability I'm going to have. So keeping this in mind, I also want to tell you something about what's happening in some of the other advanced countries, such as Europe and North America, where the discussion is about not about the skill requirements now or the skill requirements that are needed. It's about how the world of work is going to be in 20 years' time. What are the skill requirements in 2030 and 2050? And how the industry must respond. While we are obsessed with university rankings, universities globally are ranked, and they are ranked for a reason. While it also shows how good they are, but also has a commercial value, the industry is also under tremendous pressure. In a sense, it's not about showing growth figures and profits and how you are growing. It's also, there is a pressure about how responsible the industry is going to be, how sustainable their businesses are going to be. Already, you are familiar with the UN Sustainable Development Goals, which is now working with the business community. And there is tremendous pressure from the civil society and community organizations on the business community that they need to get their businesses, their industry right. No more immediate benefits. It's about long-term, sustainable kind of businesses, taking more socially responsible activities. By the way, please, I'm talking about something that which is not yet seriously discussed in this country, but it's just happening. Because the industry is getting very responsible and they are looking for doing business in a sustainable way, directly it means that they want employees who are also having the similar vision and similar thinking. If the employees need to have that, then we need to ask the question, what does the higher education institutions should be doing? So qualifications as well as preparing the necessary capacities and capabilities is very important. So keeping that in mind, I'll just run through few slides from my presentation because there's not much time. Just to reiterate some of the points I've highlighted. So this is something that we all talk about, the skill mismatch. And skill requirements are changing because of the technological advancements. And also the kind of nature of jobs are changing because of the role of automation and what is required from the industry. So a lot of discussion you must have heard already about this skill mismatch, which is a major challenge. But before we proceed, just want to show you a few slides on where things are. Say by 2020, there is an enormous demand in various industries for people with the necessary skills. But however, they feel that there is this skills gap is growing because what is needed and what the skills that are being produced, there is an enormous gap. And this skills shortage is reflected in the sense that many of the HR who are responsible for recruiting in countries across the world, they are finding it very difficult to find the sort of right graduates with having the necessary skills. As you can see, there's a selection of countries and the kind of area that they are struggling to find the right candidates. This is a very interesting survey that's taking place. It's basically show that there is a growing demand even among Indian employers in terms of more number of jobs will be created. There is likelihood these things will happen. But the problem is graduate unemployment rates is also high. That's the strange scenario. While there is a need for such wide-ranging graduates and people with different set of skills, but you still have a growing number of graduates who are unemployed. This is, by the way, it's an OECD figure. So in a sense that this raises the question as to how well our societies are able to capitalize such workforces who are actually coming out of the system. While it's the scenario in developing countries that educated workforce lacking the necessary skills, as a result, the overall economic development has to be compromised. And also, this high rates of unemployment also is kind of mismatching with the kind of qualifications that are being produced. The key point here is it's not really just the mismatch of skills, but also there's a lack of mismatch of placing the right skills with the right jobs. And to do that, you require lots of data, you require a lot of information, you require a lot of awareness about what each skill sets are that entails that is required by the industry and what sort of graduates should be going to those kind of industry. So the landscape is basically it's of very highly diverse domains. It has, for example, you have ranging from very applied advanced technologies to you have various options of developments and entrepreneurial education and also a lot of apprenticeship skills, opportunities actually available. But then while all these possibilities are there, generally it is the industry that actually defines how each of these domains is actually going to take shape. For example, whether it is creative industries, what is it that they need from the pool of graduates? What is it they need in terms of scientific capabilities? So the knowledge of effective domains in this landscape is quite dispersed. And there is no kind of agreement. There is no clear understanding as to what knowledge is where and how to tap this. This is a scenario, not just an Indian scenario, but it's actually a global scenario. It is so because of the lack of knowledge as to what the requirement of the domains and what is required from each of the disciplines, by and large, these domains that are in vogue are determined more by the more sort of anecdotal way of deciding which is in demand and which one should go for. Like in India, we tend to go by in phases. There are phases where a lot of people went for engineering courses, and now the wave is more towards arts and science. So it's more sort of anecdotal. It is not evidence-based. So as a result, at every point in time, you still have a pool of people with skills but not clearly matched with the industry requirements. So the but these collaborations between industry and academia is not really happening quite often. That is because of lack of aligning between the objectives of both these partners. And also, the problem is the capability mismatch. Is that institution does not have the skill set or the facilities to meet the needs of the industry. It also does that, while you also have a scenario where the industry also is not very clear as to what is it the academic institutions actually can offer. So there is this clear mismatches there. So what are the possible options and solutions? I'm just cutting through this. For industry and institution collaboration, it happens in various ways. It happens in a formal sense, like you have about like the skill recruitment and getting funding for research. It also happens in an informal way. They also sponsor academic conferences. They also develop R&D units. But developing employability skills through formal learning environments is very critical. As the earlier speaker mentioned, it is the curriculum design of the formal learning environments need to change a lot so that it really takes into account what the industry wants. But at the same time, as I mentioned earlier, it's not only what the industry wants now, it's about what the industry wants in the future. It's also the same curriculum about what is it we want from the graduates. They have to do in terms of their contribution to the society after they graduate. So for that, there is a lot of recommendations about bringing on people like business mentors, bringing business community into the curriculum development scenario. I had one interesting experience with the university here, that they asked me to come on board from the business community to advise on the curriculum change. So when I went and sat in the board of studies, we were reviewing the readings. I was talking about what actually the industry want from that particular subject. But then the rest of the board of study members said, "Sir, we can't change textbooks. Maybe we can chop something. If we change means we'll have problem because it will not be accepted very fast. So whatever you are telling, we can take care of in our soft skills program. That means at the end of the third year, we'll have few workshops and we'll sort it." So which means the industry's inputs about bringing in a kind of skill that will match, that will integrate knowledge that you gain from textbooks with practical scenario that is outside in the world of business, and how to solve these problems. And also calling for a very wide range set of capacities as well. But that has to be integrated into the curriculum becomes very difficult because of the nature how we see the entire curriculum design. So that becomes very difficult. Similarly, this industry, institutional interaction also happens at the level of apprenticeship, where students are sent to sort of industry for a long-term basis for getting practical experiences, especially in certain courses like business studies and other areas. But by and large, most of the students go for short-term internships. Now, these internships, we need to ask the question, why these internships are done and whether it is really having the necessary effect. Because many corporates consider internships more like a burden. They don't have time. And I've seen scenarios where students, especially coming from ordinary colleges, going to these companies, they end up doing all the very, very secondary jobs, like filing and posting, typing something. So they are basically used as substitutes, more of secretarial kind of staff, because these companies have downsized their staff so that they use this kind of intern students to do that. So at the end of the day, the students hardly get any exposure as to how the industry works, how I have to prepare myself, and what I have to do. But all you get is a piece of certificate, and then you move on. This is the kind of scenario that's, by and large, is happening. So that has to, again, need to be changed. In a sense, we have to bring on board the industry looks at such opportunities. But some industries, at the same time, use such opportunities to their advantage. There are also industries, especially multinationals, use the internship as a kind of a observation to select, pre-select potential candidates. They also use that so that they don't need to sort of look at the possibility of hiring someone whom they don't know. So those scenarios are also there. And similarly, other areas are also about having extracurricular activities, especially exposing students to voluntary work, getting to work with the communities. As I said in the beginning of my talk, this is now seen as a skill and a capacity, that is, ability of an employee to understand not only the industry, but also the society where the industry is situated and also it caters for. So increasingly, so it is not limited to courses of social work or sociology. It's the responsibility of every department and every institution to ensure their students are more aware of the global and national scenarios and socio-economic sort of problems that are facing our society. So that's very important. And another area where this interaction happens is the corporate programs, which happens quite often on campus. And a lot of these corporate programs are, again, is to tap into the talent pool that is available and select the best candidates for them. And also build some sort of a long-term loyalty so that they don't have a problem of turnover of staff. Another area that is now institution and industry are now focusing is creating the necessary language skills, because language competencies are highly the need of the hour, and also this cultural awareness. Multicultural approach to work, to life is again encouraged, because increasingly in a globalized world, you're working in a multinational situation or in an industry that requires working with people from various cultures. So these things also, industries are trying to encourage the institutions to prepare their students for their long-term future. So in a sense, all these are becoming more important. I'll quickly go through Okay. While all these are happening, there is a lot of efforts that's going on in the sort of European and North American scenario about. They're looking at not only skill shortages, but also they are looking at what else, what are the future needs. They are looking at assessing what sort of skills are needed in the future, what sort of the current job seekers' capacities as well as the requirements in the future. A lot of surveys are done in countries like Canada and UK, where they, what is known as the skill anticipation surveys. They do skill anticipation assessments by which they are able to understand what will be the future requirement and how do we integrate that into the present sort of curriculum and also teaching processes. And a lot of other countries are also looking into diverse sets of data from the labor market, pooling that into so that they can analyze and make necessary policy formulations, and that will go back directly into the higher education institutions. So this kind of anticipation of what is needed in the future is the way things are moving ahead. So therefore, there is a need for interaction, more of the sort of innovative, and it's very stronger in some industries. Some interactions are predictable, but then these things are changing. This change will be changing, provided there is more dialogue that happens between the various players. We talk about the triple helix model between the industry, the institution, and the government. So this dialogue has to happen in terms of not only providing the right kind of labor force to the for the market requirements, but also preparing the present labor force with the right set of skills, not only for the economic reasons, but also for the social reasons. More than that, governments has to come up with policy level initiatives which will ensure what will be the future skill needs, what will be the future skill requirements that are needed, and that has to translate into both sensitizing the industries as well as putting necessary frameworks and policies within the higher education institutions so that the country is prepared for the future. So while you have accreditation and other ways of looking at the quality of education, there is a growing need that institutions should look forward to the future, which is more than economic, it's also a social need. With these few words, I thank the organizers of this conference for giving opportunity to share a few of these thoughts. This is a huge subject, but my purpose was to just to bring your attention to the world of employment, that it's not about just finding jobs for getting salaries. It's also about finding the right person for the right jobs, as well as people who will be responsible for the world that we live in tomorrow. Both industry and the institutions have this responsibility to do that. Thank you very much.